Hello, my fellow rockers. How are you all doing this evening? I hope you're doing well. We're going to get started with one of those bad boys right there. Timothy Lay says, nice shirt. It's my Kiss shirt. Thank you. I have Gene Simmons somewhere over here. Gene, where are you? There's Gene Simmons. So let's see who was first tonight. Let me scroll to the top. I have this microphone way out here tonight. I don't know why. Were the levels okay? Did everything sound okay? First in this evening was Dusty Wilson, dude. One of those. Followed up by Guitar Man 45, Darth Shredder, Metal Makes Me Crazy, Tim Thomas, AQ, Dude, Fast Eddie, Brian from Oregon, Grandpa Joe. You could share one of those bad boys right there, since you're both good peeps. All right, I'm going to scroll to the bottom. Leo says, sounds good. Brian says, sounds great. Kiss, AQ. This is your shirt, dude. I stole it from you when you weren't looking. Idiot Burns sounded great. Good. Okay, excellent. Natasha. Jose Benito Martinez Jr. Hello. Quentin James. Picks and Paint. Janice Lala. Hello. Oh, yes, more than okay. Good, good. So, I have something new, exciting, and special for you today, like I always have for you. I have two things, actually. The first thing, I have a guitar here, and I have two pedals over there. I'll give you a quick peek. Hang on. So, those are the pedals. Oh, maybe I should move the headstock. The Raider and the Bones. And that's what you got to hear on the kind of the second piece of what I was playing with a little bit of gain. Let me come back over here. And then we have, brand new this evening, we have Tribe. I bet you never, you know, the title says two brands I bet you never heard of before. One of this is called Tribe Guitars, okay? And I was actually turned on to Tribe from a buddy of mine. His name is Oren. Oren's a good guy, I know him for many years, and he was telling me he was working with Tribe, and you know, one thing led to another, and here we are, okay? So this one here, and by the way, all the links are in the description. Tribe was, it's a relatively new company. You know, they were started in 2007, okay? They are a Swiss brand. They're Swiss, right? Switzerland. And this guitar here is the Eagle Classic. This one here is the kind of vintage white on the white pickguard. Maybe I should, I'll give you a quick little spin on the guitar. Let me give you some spec also. I know I have some spec somewhere over here. Hang on. I always do my homework. So Eagle Classic, single, okay? Three single coils, vintage white pickguard, has a bolt-on neck. It's a very Strat-esque guitar, okay? American Alder body. I think it's a two-piece urethane finish. Goto or Wilkinson. Oh, Wilkinson by Goto. Okay. Goto. Okay. 25 and a half inch scale. Your very Strat-esque scale length. Roasted maple neck on the back, which is very nice. Locking tuners. Bone nut. Peo Ferro fingerboard on here. And it just looks and sounds pretty good. And it comes with a nice gig bag, which is this bad boy right over here. Okay, I don't know the millimeters of padding, but it's a good gig bag. And that is what's new tonight. And I'll give you some licks and stuff. And then I have two pedals over there. And we'll talk about the pedals second. Let me just give you some clean licks on the guitar. Okay. And there's also, I guess, six different pickup options. So it's a three-way blade, but you have this little toggle switch down here. And if the toggle switch is down, you have your neck pickup, your neck and your bridge, and then just your bridge pickup, okay? And then if you have the toggle switch up, it's the neck and the middle, all pickups, or the middle and the bridge. So I'll just fiddle around with it, and let's just hear what this bad boy sounds like. I didn't realize I was talking on mute. I said I will start on clean, and then we'll turn over to dirty a little bit. So really just chimey and clean. I actually tend to favor the, there we go, the neck pickup. The bridge sounds like a bridge, the neck sounds like a neck, but I feel like on this kind of guitar, the neck pickup is really where it's at. So let me give you a little bit of that. Ike says, really mellow for a single coil to my ears. It's a very mellow guitar. Now, just in full transparency, I'm using the Friedman on the clean channel, but I do have that going through an EQ. That amp is a little trebly for me, so I'm EQing the high end down a little bit. You might be hearing some of that. So, let me give you a little bit more on the clean, and then we'll go to like a slight gain, and then we'll talk about the pedals, and we'll give you some high gain. So that's the clean. On the Friedman, I'm going to go on the basically the JCM 800 channel with the gain dialed down. Let's check that out. So a little bit of gain, but no pedals or anything like that. Nothing high gain. Does come with a trem arm. It's not in the guitar. It's in the case. It is surface mounted though, so if you use the trem arm, it should come back nicely. That setting is a little bit muddy through my soundbar. How did that sound? I'm curious to know everyone's thoughts. Michael D says it's got the single coil chime. I agree with you. James Norton says looks like the Vigier with a Sir headstock. Okay. This is great. Too much chime. Ice picky. Okay. And like I said, it could be the EQ settings I have. That's a very finicky amp. But I own it. I want to use it. That's why it's there. I actually have... It's not a very forgiving amp. I have a lot of amps that are a lot more forgiving. But I want to use it. It's probably the most money I've ever spent on an amp. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is... By the way, comfort-wise, it sounds very nice. It feels very nice. It plays really nice. The 11 says, so it's a Strat. Yeah, I mean, this is kind of a Strat-esque guitar. You know? It's exactly what it is. It's their own pickups, Alnico 5s. You know, that vintage white Peo Ferro. Good, you know, it's well constructed, bone nut, locking tuners, matching headstock. It's got quality components as far as I'm concerned. The roasted maple neck, the USA alder body, etc., etc. Jim's home studio says, like the way you sound tonight. Thank you. It does have locking tuners on the back. Those are locking. There you go. You could see it right there. Yeah, the toggle switch, for those that missed it, will give you different pickup options. Hit rewind. I went through what those were. And, you know, equally, it sounds pretty good with a little bit of gain. Which brings me to this next part. Let me switch screens. So what we have over here, we have two brand new pedals. One is called the Raider. One is called the Bones. Okay. Now, Fallen Raider Audio is the company. And they are hand-built here in the USA by veterans. Okay. So the whole goal was to give veterans, you know, those that served in the military, an outlet to build stuff for us. Okay. So the first one, the Raider pedal, is basically a boost to a distortion. It has a little bit of compression in the circuit, which, you know, compression is supposed to give you resonance and, you know, response and some equal, like, picking stuff, right? It does what a compressor is supposed to do. Has low, mid, highs, true bypass. Very straightforward pedal, and a gain and a volume. And then the Bones, which is very interesting, has it's more of like a boost to a fuzz. And there's the thump, which interestingly enough, you hear when the gain is all the way up. And as you roll it back, it gives you the thump. When it's kind of dead in the center, you don't hear it. You actually have to roll it back to hear the thump. So it's almost serving more like a filter, okay? So I will give you a, and by the way, links in the description on those as well. But let's check those out. Let me first go on a crystal clear channel, because right now I'm on that kind of throaty channel. Let me go clean. And let's start with the Bones. So you could see right there that as I roll it back, it gets thicker. So it's almost as if it's filtering as you roll it up. Now, what's interesting is the order in which I have them. The Raider is a good distortion pedal. The Bones I like is a boost. So having this go into the Raider, well, when I play them both, you'll hear exactly what I'm hearing. Natasha says, I'm listening through studio monitors. The guitar didn't sound too spiky to me. Natasha, I'm also listening to two KRK V8s stereo studio monitors, and it sounds perfect to me here. You know, that's one of the challenges with doing this sort of thing is you always, you know, it depends what you're listening to and the EQ on what you're listening to, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm glad you told me that because I check everything before we go live, and I'm through pretty flat studio monitors. So thank you for telling me that. Rock Daddy says, you're listening through your Spark. Nice lows. Well, that's a good thing to listen to. Okay, so that's the Bones. Here's the Raider, and then I'm going to put them together. Let's check it out. Which, like that, actually makes for a really nice boost. And it does advertise as boost to distortion. And I know a lot of companies will say that as marketing. It does this to that. But this actually is a boost. If you bring up the volume, roll down the gain, it's actually a nice boost. Thank you. two pedals that I think work really well together, really gives you some harmonic and thickness without the gain. And for those that watch my stuff know I like lots of gain. As far as I'm concerned, that was very clean. That sounded to me very clean. So I'm still on the very clean channel on the amp. Let me go to the JCM-800 channel on the amp. Then we'll put those back on to give it kind of push the overdrive on the amp a little bit. There, it's still very clean to me. It's not like harsh or raspy. Very warm. That's what it sounds like. Why are gold guitars so awesome? Oh, because they're awesome. Thank you. I just think it cuts through really good. Let's see. Russell said, good job. Thank you. It's hard to generate some nice feedback stuff without ice picking everyone. Yeah. Well, an easy way to do it is get a boost into a distortion pedal into an already overdriven little amp, and you'll get it real easy. Crystal Light Peach Mango tonight. Cheers, everyone. Cheers. I don't know. For me, there's something. Hang on. Let me come back over here. There's something really nice about hearing an amp go into, like, oscillation. But this here is the guitar. I'll stand up. I'll give you a quick little once-over, and then we'll wrap this segment up. And that, my fellow rockers, is the Tribe guitar. Picks and Pain sent some, put some links in the description. Thank you, dude. I appreciate that. We should catch up soon, too, also, by the way. It's been a while. And I'd love to have you come on the show, dude. I invited a buddy of mine to come on the show and just haven't really worked that out yet, but we will. I want to talk about just some repair stuff that he's done for some of my guitars, one of my guitars, and I'd like for that to happen. Would you like to have a whole thing on talking about just general repair? Do you think that would be a good thing to chat about? Russell Zanis says, every Tribe I've seen, I think it's a little overpriced. In full transparency, oh, thank you. Thank you. In full transparency, like I said, you know, I always tell you guys the truth. This was sent to me by my buddy Oren to check out. Oren, I've known for many, many years. He's one of the good guys, right? And he and I were talking about it, and he was actually supposed to come here. I was a little disappointed that he didn't. But he said, dude, I really want you to check it out. And I'm glad he did, especially because I don't, you know, it's funny. I have a lot of Strats. I don't really play a lot of Strats. I wind up, you know, it's funny. Everyone says, you always sound the same. And they're right, because I always play the same type of thing. Even different guitars. You know, I like humbuckers, high gain. So for me, musically, it's nice to play something a little different. And what I was really enjoying, if you caught the video when it first started, was just really kind of doing some of that lead work with real chimey tones, like Strat tones. There's something really nice about that that I don't treat myself too often with. And again, I have guitars to do that. So when I committed to doing this with Oren, it was like, I was really excited about it. And it's a nice guitar. But because he did send this over, I'm not sure of the prices. But I did include the link. There's one dealer in the USA. They're kind of rare. They're not, you know, it's not like you could walk into a guitar center and find one. But the one dealer that I am aware of in the U.S., that link is in the description. Just check it out. You know, I'm not sure. Russell says, Tribe also makes some configurations that aren't super common but are sort of desirable. Well, I thought the pickup options were pretty cool. Picks and Paint says roughly $800. Okay. Well, you know what? In my humble opinion, anything under $1,000 is a good deal today for a good guitar. And again, you're getting lock and tuners, roasted maple neck, bone nut, Alnico 5 pickups, you know, just a nice combination. I would say it's probably priced right for what it is. alder body, you know, two-piece alder. I think that's priced right. RRDE says 800 isn't bad. I agree. If you said it was $1,500 or $2,000, that's when you get to like the, there's a lot of options out there. But 800 for a good guitar that you don't have to upgrade, I think is probably the right price, you know. So picks and paints, if you saw that on the Euro website, I think the Euro is higher than the dollar. So in dollars, it's probably less. I think it's less. Euros is more than dollars. So that might be 600 US dollars. You'd have to call the dealer. Natasha says anything with bass would please. So those were, you know, two very exciting things. I really do like the story with Raider, with the two pedals built by veterans. You know, there's, I don't care where you're from, what country you're from. I think it's important to celebrate those that, you know, provide our freedoms and our liberties and all that. So anytime I see something with veterans, and I encourage each of you also to look into that. But anything veterans, I'm very thankful for. You know, our peace and liberty and, you know, freedoms don't come cheap, as we all know, and as we all see on the news right now. When I heard that this was a company that was, you know, owned by veterans, built by veterans, it's like, you know, that's, to me, that's a good cause. And they make a good product. So, not trying to get political, just, you know, factual. I think it's important to support, you know, your veterans, wherever you live, right? Those that, you know, are fighting for you. Because, you know, it could be taken away from you like that, right? So, Natasha says, I like supporting veterans and U.S. workers in general. Yeah, me too. I do also. And I think anyone here, wherever you live, it's important to support your local economy, right? Wherever you live on earth, it's important to support those around you. Those that protect you, those around you, those, you know, it's your own community. That's important stuff that's often overlooked, right? Ian's Guitar Sack said people died for our freedom. So yeah, absolutely. You know, and, you know, unfortunately, you know, with the internet and with some of the, and just to be clear, I'm not getting political, just kind of matter of fact, you know, the world got smaller, right, with the birth of the internet, being able to get anything from anywhere, right? That's good and it's bad because, you know, everyone's conditions are different. People work for less here, work for more here, and it offsets things a little bit, makes it tough for some economies. Both for the worker. I mean, we've all heard, and if you notice, I'm purposely leaving countries out because I don't want to go down that road. But, you know, some of these things that you could buy cheap, you really have to question, why is it so cheap, right? You know, are people getting paid the right amount, right? So it's nice to get cheap stuff. Listen, we all like a deal. You know, it's funny. I had a contractor here today. I've had a few contractors here just doing some odds and ends. And I always told them, I said, I want to keep you in business, right? Because I depend on you. And I think it's important to, you know, not always get the best deal, but to make sure that you're also not killing the person that you're buying from, because you want them to be in business, you know. Anyway, Russell said, time for global peace. Absolutely, absolutely. Amps with tubes are going to go nuts with price. Yeah. Although I heard that, I forget the company. I'm sure someone in the chat will know, that there was an American company that were kind of putting feelers out there that have the capability of producing tubes here in the USA. Because I think the tubes, the last I checked, tubes were made in Russia and China. And that was it. And with all the sanctions and the shipping and the delays and the ports that are closed, it's tough. You know, I'm assuming that the U.S. is probably the largest market for tube amps. I'm guessing. I don't know. Maybe the U.K. is a second runner-up. But, you know, that makes it tough when there's none that are domestic. Most of the new bands I like aren't from the U.S., so I'd be cutting myself off from a lot of great stuff if I went all hyper-nationalist. I don't know what hyper-nationalist means. Russell, I don't understand what you're telling me, and I apologize. Give it another go. Johnny A. said I heard that too. Yep. Yeah, John Doe, or anyone here that is served and protected somebody's freedom. That's for you right there. That's important stuff. The Guitologist. Dude, what is going on, my man? He wrote, to put this into perspective, the largest city in the U.S. has only about 9 million people in it. China has no less than 8 cities with more people than that. Russell says, most states have a local civilian defense force, not a militia, but you actually get access to local National Guard, which is also your local defense. There's nothing stopping you, anyone from helping. Yeah, oh, thank you, Grandpa Joe, Western Electric. I actually know a lot of people that do serve on the National Guard, people that I work with, you know, day in and day out. Rico B says, did you see the new Charvel Jakey Lee 1299? I did. And the only reason why I didn't jump on that was because I have the USA Custom Shop, which I bought before that one came out. And I already have the good one. Not to say that the 1299 one is bad, but I don't need two identical guitars. Especially when I have the good. Same thing with the Warren D. Martini. I have the USA Custom Shop snakeskin. And then they came out with the, I forget what it's called, the Pro Mod series, the Mexican snakeskin. And I'm like, eh, I don't need. I got the good one, so I'm going to hang. But listen, if you want that guitar, I checked spec for spec. I think the wood is different. There was minor differences, very minor differences. If I didn't own the Custom Shop one, I absolutely positively would buy it. Guitar Bert says 800 euros, 843. Oh, okay, so it's more. I had it backwards. John Doe says, China's army is bigger than our population. Well, there's a lot of people there. Johnny says, blue Jakey Lee, cool guitar, but not the white. Black Corvo. Dude, what is going on? I like both. I own both. You would think I'm a Jakey Lee fanatic for owning two USA Custom Shop Jakey Lee guitars. I never thought I was fanatic, but if you followed the money, you would say I was a Jakey Lee fanatic. I just like those guitars, you know. Rick Killen says, finally building your Rockboard pedal board. Very cool. Brian from Argon says, Tribe guitars Far East made? It's a Swiss brand. I know that. I know they are not made in China. That I know. I think they are made in Korea. I think. Which from import perspective is probably at the top of the food chain. Most highest demand. I'm pretty sure they're made in Korea. This model anyway. I think they have some models that are Swiss made. They have some models that are import made. And I am almost certain they're made in Korea. And I know for a fact they don't make guitars in China. So I've been told. And I think in the pecking order, it's probably today for imported guitars is, well, Japan. But it's weird. You know, I don't know. I have an odd way of thinking about this. I don't consider Japan an imported guitar. Probably because listen, I know I'm going to piss somebody off, so let me apologize in advance. And I'm overgeneralizing here, I'm aware of that. But let's just say a USA guitar is the a good guitar, okay? I put Japanese-made guitars on the same shelf as a USA-made guitar. I think they've been doing it a long time. I think the craftsmanship is spectacular. So it's funny, if I see a guitar that's made in Japan, I don't consider that an imported guitar, even though it kind of is. I see it as a premium guitar. Imported guitars are usually, my brain associates it with more affordable, right? An affordable guitar. And I think that pecking order starts with Korea, probably then Indonesia. Although Indonesia, I understand a lot of the Indonesian factories are owned by Koreans, I believe. So quality control and all that. Picks and Paints says agreed. Made in Japan equals USA. Yep. Even in my list of, like when I have a list of guitars that I own, all 12 of them, and they're color coded, and my Made in Japan is the same color coded as my Made in USA. I think they're, quality wise, I think they're on par. Now, of course, a Gibson Les Paul Custom is always going to be, you know, something special, or a USA Fender Strata is always going to be something special because the type of guitar it is. Those two models aside, you know, you take your favorite brand USA guitar, your Sur guitar, or your my Jackson Made in Japan. I said this on a live show not too long ago. My Jackson Dinky MJ series, it's just as good as the Sur. I would put it against the Sur all day long. So there you go. You have you know, a USA Sur, a Made in Japan Jackson. I think they are, I don't think there's a winner. Hello, kitty. Come here. So, come here. Look. Today is Hazel's birthday. Hazel is 5 today. So if everyone wants to wish Hazel a happy birthday, my kitty. She's 5. Do you love me? And I have another cat, Baby, who only likes to come to me when I'm laying down on the couch over here. Hazel, say goodbye. Say goodbye to everybody. Today is her birthday, 5 years old. She was just being greedy for everyone's birthday wishes. That's why she wanted to be on camera. Andrew Collins says, you're kidding, right? Japanese guitars don't compare with American-made guitars. Well, like I said, minus the... Let me qualify that. I've never played a Japanese-made Les Paul that was better than a Gibson Les Paul. That's my experience. If you take your Fender Strat aside and your Gibson Les Paul aside, every other guitar, right? I use the example of my Jackson Made in Japan, my MJ Series Jackson. It's just as good as my Sur all day long. I think the two exceptions are a Gibson Les Paul and a Fender Strat. There's something very special about those two guitars. I think most guitar players would agree, whether you love them or hate them, they have a sound, they have a tone, they have a look, they have a history that make them special guitars. But your Shredder guitars or your Strat-esque guitars, I think, I think the Japanese craftsmanship, and again, I know it's an overgeneralization. I'm sure somewhere in Japan they make crap guitars, just like some places here they make crap guitars. But if you put the best craftsmen up against each other, I think Japanese produces outstanding instruments. My Vola guitars, they're made in Japan. Outstanding. They're outstanding. You know? Andrew Collins says, what about the American PRS guitars? Listen, I think an American PRS is an outstanding instrument. See, that's what I'm saying. If you get specific, Andrew, I haven't played a Japanese PRS style guitar. So I don't know what I could compare an American PRS to. That's why I use the Sur and my Jackson as an example. When I compare two similar guitars, I think they're equally fine. I haven't played a Japanese-made PRS-style guitar. Guitologist says, I think the ESP Eclipse is technically superior to most Les Pauls. Yeah, the ESP Eclipse, actually, any ESP. In fact, I haven't taken them out in a while. I happen to own, after I just told you what a spectacular guitar the Fender Strat is, I happen to own a set. It's an ESP Vintage Plus, Vintage Plus Strat, and a Vintage Plus Tele. I think they're perhaps better than any Strat or Tele that I own. So to the guitologist's point, I think that ESP produces an outstanding instrument. Brian from Oregon says, Japan ESP, enough said. In fact, I'll tell you all a little secret, and it has to be a secret because I'm very friendly with the guys at ESP. I think everyone knows that. This could come across insulting someone, but it's really a compliment. If I had to choose between a USA ESP or a Japanese-made ESP, I'd take the Japanese ESP. After I just told you how important it is to support your local economy. If I had to buy one, I'd buy the USA one. I'd be supporting my local economy. But if a magical thing showed, a genie showed up in front of me and said, which one do you want? Take one. I would take the Japanese made one. I just think the ESP is probably one of my favorite Japanese brands. You know, they've been doing it a while. They know what they're doing. If you've ever, just go look at the ESP NAMM show coverage. I mean, some of the stuff they're doing that comes out of Japan is pretty spectacular. You know, it's funny, someone brought up PRS before. PRS has done a really nice job of carving out its own market. You know, even when they were first introduced, guitologists, I agree with you. ESP has had their stuff together since the 80s. They're truly legit. I agree. It's one of those, if it says ESP on the headstock, you know you're getting a good guitar. You know, even if it's a bolt-on, it's a good guitar, right? I was saying about PRS, they've really carved out a niche for themselves. Off the top of my head, I can't really think. Of course, some of like the Harley Bentons went after, you know, PRS. They came out with PRS knockoffs, right? Other companies have too, but PRS, I feel like, is its own thing. They've done a good job. Even when they were first introduced to the market, they kind of wedged themselves between a Strat and a Les Paul. Said you could get both sounds out of this one guitar, and they've stayed kind of the path. Except recently, they perhaps two of their best-selling guitars is the Silver Sky, which happens to be a Strat, and a 594, which happens to be a Les Paul. So in a weird kind of way, I feel like they've abandoned the very thing that they have created, you know, that special, like the Custom 24, right? That was their baby. What's interesting is, listen, here's the reality. Everybody, again, I'm generalizing. I know I'm generalizing. Everybody wants a Strat. Everybody wants a Les Paul. That's a fact, right? So I think PRS is producing what people want. They made the Silver Sky. They made the Strat. They made the 594, which is the Les Paul. So in a weird, weird, weird kind of way, I ask myself why. They have their own thing. It's not like Gibson is making a Custom 24, right? It's not like Fender's making a Silver Sky. So a little bit, it confirms that the Strat and the Les Paul are two of the most iconic guitars on earth. Natasha. I think you sent me a picture of your custom 24 Natasha. And I saw the picture of your base, which is outstanding. I didn't see the headstock, though. I think it was a Gibson. In fact, Natasha, one of the things I sold, which I wish I didn't, it wasn't even a lot of money. I used to have an Epiphone Thunderbird. What's the base? The Thunderbird? And it said, custom World's Records. Welcome to join this channel. Words Records. Thank you. So one of the guitars I sold a while ago, you know, every once in a while you got to purge. And one of the ones that went was an Epiphone Thunderbird bass, which looked just like yours, the picture you sent, which I think is a Gibson. I'm not a bass player. I have a few basses, but man, I love that. I miss that guitar. I wish I still had it. It was just such a looker. So the guitologist, so nice to have you here tonight, man. I hope you're doing okay. We should talk soon. It's been a while. Lord JP says, my 86 Kramer JK1000 is made by ESP in Japan. Yep. It wasn't a Nikki 6 bass. It's funny. I wanted the Nikki 6 bass, but I didn't like that it was all matte black. So I bought the... It was an Epiphone custom shop. I think it was a limited edition custom. In fact, it was silk screened on the back, limited edition custom shop. I don't remember the exact model. I have a picture of it somewhere. But it was beautiful. It was a beautiful bass. I wound up selling it, geez, 10 years ago, something like that. It was one of those, I bought it. Yeah, it was the Thunderbird. I bought it, never used it. It was like, okay, I got to clear some stuff out, you know. Al John in the house, dude. I don't know if I gave you one of those in case I didn't. One of those bad boys right there. So my fellow rockers, there's a couple. So that wraps up tonight with the Tribe guitar and the new pedals that I showed you. I hope you enjoyed the demo and all that. One of the things I committed to you, hang on one second. Do I still have them over here? My runway audio. In one of my upcoming videos, I want to do a cable test, but I want to get like my nice clean amp over here, no effects, nothing. Just do a cheap cable and a good cable so you could hear that. I know I committed to that last live show. I just have to move some things around and mic it up and all that, or maybe I'll do it in the other room. And then I had a company reach out to me, and maybe I'll do this next week. It's a small little Amazon company called AI Tone, and we'll do a quick impromptu unboxing here. But this here is a looper and a tuner pedal, and I'll hook this up next time, but I'll give you a little sneak peek. So this here, let me back up so you could see the unboxing. Comes with a little USB cable. And this is basically a looper and a tuner made by AI Tone. I'm not even going to link it in the description. I'll link it. This is if you hung out here for 56 minutes, you get to see a quick little unboxing. This here is interesting. This is a noise reduction microphone. It's one of these companies that has lots of stuff on Amazon. And this one here is a noise reducing lapel microphone. Perfect if you're doing YouTube videos or something like that. So I'll show you that next week also. Very affordable stuff. And then there over here is a multi-effects headphone guitar amplifier. I'm actually curious to hook this up. And check this bad boy out. Hang on. USB rechargeable. And basically, let me read it first and then I'll tell you what it says. So there's an on-off. You could store your settings. You have a tuner on here. And you have amp, gain, tone, modulation, time-based effects, mix, reverb, IRs, and a tuner on here, all in this little thing. And then you could plug your headphones into it. So I could probably do the headphone out into my mixer and give you a live feed on that. So they had reached out. They said, hey, we have some cool stuff. I think these are the only three products that they sell. So on my next live show, I will I'll hook these three things up and share with you. Yeah, little preview for next week. So by the way, next Friday, I will not be having a live show. So, and I can't have one Saturday either. So let me ask you a question. Should I skip next week or should we do a live show on maybe Thursday? What do you think? I'm kind of thinking about taking a week off, but I'm curious to poll everyone. You good if we take a week off? James Norton says, did I ever do a Noro review? I did not. Take a week off. 11. I like that. Thank you. Oh, Natasha, thank you, dude. I appreciate that. John Prendergast just got home from work. Take a week off. All right. I'm going to take next week off. So no live show next week. You got to do what works best for you. I know. And I appreciate that. Next week, I'm taking off. So in 2 weeks, I'll hook this stuff up. And maybe we'll do some cable tests and all that stuff as well. So my fellow rockers, thank you for being here tonight. I appreciate you all being here. Wouldn't be what it is if you weren't hanging out. If you enjoy the show, give me a thumbs up on your way out. And, thank you everyone for hanging out. Be safe. Play the guitar. Make some music. And, of course, I'm going to leave you all off with one of those bad boys right there. My fellow rockers, have a good weekend. Be safe. Rock on. Thank you. Take care. And I will see you all in 2 weeks. See you later. Luca. Take care. Natasha, Tim Thomas, Black Corvo, Ian's, BB, Brian from Oregon, Timothy, Sky Prop, Quentin James, The Guitologist. We do need to catch up this week. Grandpa Joe, Picks and Paints, Sasso, Rock Daddy, James Norton, Ike, RRD. See you in 2 weeks. And if I missed you, group hug right there. I'll see you all later. Take care. Thanks.